Qantas Airlines was founded almost 100 years ago, in 1920, and began giving international passenger flights in 1935. It's Australia's top airline and carries 15% of all travelers coming and going from Australia. While it's well known that on Qantas you will be satisfied with timely flights, the majority of the world is largely in the dark on whether or not your taste buds will be satisfied with delicious snacks. Today we pull back the curtain on Qantas in-flight seats and ask, You Tried Dat? Happy New Year! It's You Tried Dat. I'm Nick Novak with my pals Chad Hancock.
2019, baby! Woo!
Nick Geiger.
Auld Lang Syne.
I'm uninviting you from my New Year's party. So New Year's, as a general fact, is not the best holiday, as I think most people would agree to.
Yeah.
But do you guys have any New Year's from past that really stick out above the others?
I mean, not only would I say it's not the best, it might be the worst. It's certainly up there. I don't know. There's just something about, like, we used to try to celebrate New Year's, you know, like the way you're supposed to, right? Like you go out and go to a bar or something and then try to watch fireworks somewhere. And it's just like so crowded. Everything's so overpriced. I don't know. It just seems kind of lame. So what we started doing actually a few years ago was we would go out of the country on trips when we were on New Year's. And then that actually worked out pretty well. Like we ended up with a couple of pretty fun New Year's that way. There was, remember one time we were in Belize, down in Central America for New Year's. And we're in this town called Plasencia, which is like not a very big town. There's not really any big towns in Belize. The whole population of the country is like 300,000 or something. But we went to this bar and like it was basically the only bar in town that was having a New Year's celebration. But I remember our hotel owner was like making a big deal out of it because she's like, oh, you guys, there's like this really famous DJ that's going to be playing New Year's at the bar. And no joke, his name was Titty Man Flores. So we were like, all right, we absolutely have to go to this bar. And I actually have a picture of Titty Man Flores. Like I met him there that night. And he was basically exactly as sort of like goofy as you would expect.
So that wasn't his real name, you think?
I don't know, might have been. Might have been his birthday, but he spelled it T-I-T-I Man Flores, right. So I don't know if he was actually talking about something else, but probably not.
Did he have like giant tits?
Yeah, he should have called himself Double D Cup Flores.
Like I thought maybe it was just about him. I don't know.
So that was a pretty good one. We also had a good one down in Chile, where we went to a town or a city in Chile called Valparaiso. And they have like one of the biggest New Year's Eve celebrations in South America there, because the way that town is set up, it's like it's just like a big C shape, like on a bay, and then it's a hill. So everybody just gets on hills throughout the town, and then they just shoot off like an absolute shitload of fireworks in the bay. Then I remember it was just like super crowded, like wall to wall people, and there was like a couple people next to us that were just so drunk. And this Brazilian woman next to me. And she was just slurring through her words like, yeah, this is pretty good, but it's so much better at Copacabana Beach in Brazil. And she just kept talking about how the Brazilian New Year's was like so much better. And I'm like, you know, I'm not from here. Like, I don't care. Like, I'm not taking offense to any of this.
Did you get to listen to the famous Chilean DJ Boobs McStoodzy?
He was there, yeah. He was there.
Geiger, do you remember New Year's when we were going downtown to the city and we brought a bunch of beers? I think we may or may not even been legal age to drink, but we brought a bunch of beers to the hotel, and then we had no bottle opener with us. Like, we bought ones without a twist-off cap.
I think we bought Coronas. And they don't twist off, and we had no way to get them open. We like called down the front desk, and, like, we've got a wine cork, but they didn't have, like, I remember someone like remembering that you could put the edge of a bottle on the side of a table and start hitting it. I'm like, you're just going to break a glass. So we just had a bunch of Coronas we couldn't drink. We were morons.
Like something that happens to the characters in American Pie or something. Like, it's so stupid.
Why didn't we just go to a liquor store and like get a bottle opener?
Who knows?
Okay.
Why was there four of us sleeping in one hotel room? I don't know.
We were right across from the club that we were going to go and spend like the evening at. And I think we just decided we would actually fork over $20 and buy a drink at the club.
Yeah. So. I'm with Chad. That's the reason why Muscles things stink, because you go to these clubs and it's, oh, you get this wristband, it's all you can drink, and then you just wait in line for 45 minutes to get half a watered-down gin and tonic that they're pouring. Like, because the bartender's just like, I hate my life! They're just, like, scrambling around.
Yeah.
This leads into one of the greatest stories, though, which I forgot, was that Geiger met a lovely lady that night. And then... it wasn't about that night, but then later you kind of kept in contact with her and she lived in another state, and I'll let you take it from there.
Yeah. I mean, we went to some big club in Chicago and I saw a girl that I thought was my ex-girlfriend. So I went up to talk to her. It turned out it wasn't, but we ended up talking anyway and then hanging out that night.
It was your future ex-girlfriend.
Yeah. She was my future ex-stalker. So
that was your pickup line too.
Yeah. We ended up hanging out that night. And she lived in Michigan, and I lived in Wisconsin at the time. So I got her phone number, and we talked a little bit after, and she kept trying to say, like, oh, just drive to Michigan. And I'm like, that's an absurdly long drive from Wisconsin. You got to go all the way around the lake. And she just kept implying, like, oh, if you come, I'll make it worth your while. I'm like, yeah, that's okay. But we didn't really have that much in common. I was getting kind of tired of talking to her.
Well, at that point in your life, let's get things straight. At that point in your life, okay. You would have driven over the ocean in your car.
Yeah,
I may have applied something.
I was trying to talk my dad into loading me money to just load me into a cannon and fire me across the lake. I'm not too proud to admit that there's a good length of time I would have driven for an encounter such as that at one point in time. But I think it was more just she was getting kind of weird. And that was exemplified by the fact that one time she had mentioned one time when we were talking, like, oh, my favorite song is In Your Eyes by Peter Gabriel, which, A, that song sucks. But B, I didn't realize when I first was talking to her, I'm like, oh, I don't know that one. Like, it's one of those songs that you know when you hear it, but I didn't really recognize it when she said it. Like, yeah. So one day she calls me, I'm in the car, and I answer the phone, and she goes, listen. And she just holds her phone up to the radio, and it's In Your Eyes of Peter Gabriel. And then I go, oh, yeah, cool. All right. Now I know what you're talking about. And she just kept playing it. And I'm like, excuse me? Hello? And she wouldn't. She just held it up to the radio for the entirety of a 4 or 5 minute song. And I think I just hung up. Because I was I'm not going to sit here driving, listen to someone else's radio. And she called back, why'd you hang up? I'm like, how long were you going to play me the fucking song? Like, I figured it out. Nope. Hold on, I'm driving 31 more hours, so you can maybe kiss me on the cheek.
You should have just told her when it comes to Peter Gabriel songs, it's Sledgehammer or GTFO.
Right. So she was getting kind of weird and doing stuff like that, so we stopped talking. But for that one night, it was fun. I do also distinctly recall getting back to our hotel room, and the three of you guys are all sharing a bed and giggling and stuff like that. Like, what the hell? But and then I climbed into that bed too. So yeah, dudes on New Year's. What fucking pimps we were.
Wasn't there like pretty much an entire I remember most of college you would only have sex to Sledgehammer.
Yes. Yeah. I wanna be, and I'd be like, in fact, now when I hear that song, I just get uncomfortably erect. I can't. It's like a Pavlovian response. I can't walk. I can't think.
It's your Viagra.
Right. Right. That I don't even need to get spaded or whatever they call it when humans do it. I just need to hear
what?
That. I'm kidding.
Spaded?
I'm kidding. Yes.
We're just... Someone just lops off your dick with a spade.
That's no. Spade. Ironically, what I heard was that they just take a sledgehammer to your penis. It's you walk in and Gallagher is like,
Dr. Gallagher.
Exactly. Dr. Gallagher, MD, is like, you know what I think we ought to do with our Bill of Rights? And just smashes a penis with a sledgehammer.
The problem with the government is there's too many penises in Washington. Smash.
I am literally just spending the rest of this podcast setting Chad up to do Gallagher, because it's not even that accurate, but I love his Gallagher voice.
I think the last time I had one of those sort of crazy club New Year's was the first New Year's after I moved out to San Francisco. And I remember I was at a place that was like bottomless drinks, and I had way too many. And then we were taking the subway home, and I remember being in the subway station, and I had been drinking vodka cranberries all night. I remember that distinctly. I remember in the subway station, we got to the subway station, and I knew that I was not going to make it back home before like I had to puke. So I just like ran into the little disgusting bathroom that's at the subway station. You know, it's like always the grossest bathrooms ever. And then I get in there and I see that the toilet is like clogged and full to the point where it's like ready to overflow. So I'm like, I can't puke in the toilet, right? It's just going to like cause stuff to. So I just puked in the sink. But then for some reason, the sink was all clogged. So I just like remember like leaving this bathroom and like I had filled up the sink with just like red liquid that I had just puked out. And I was just like, oh man, I feel so bad for the poor worker that's going to have to clean this up tomorrow. The toilet's clogged. The sink is full of vomit.
We have not had one of those stories in a while where puking or shitting or something like that.
Novak, any New Year's stories for you or no?
There's one time that I was out with Titty Manflores.
And you were like, it's 2018. Why isn't there no Balls Manflores? Right? Yeah. Hashtag equality.
Yep. That's what a clog means. Yep.
I will actually, the day that this is released, be in the air on the way to Texas. I'll be spending this New Year's in Texas. Oh. That'll be the first one probably that I wasn't like in the general vicinity for. So, but I can't think of any that come to mind a ton. And the thing is just, as you get older, you just try to plan something that you know will be relaxing and won't go wrong. And especially when you have kids, and Geyer, you can attest to this. New Year's just completely changes because your kids aren't staying up late, but they want to enjoy it. So you try to, you like play the countdown at like 9 o'clock, and then everyone kind of...
Yeah. It's midnight somewhere.
Then, no, I think there is even like an app where you can just like put it on and it'll count down and then like shoot fireworks off. And they're like, oh, it's the next day, because they don't understand time. And then just tell them to go to bed and you get hammered on by yourself.
Exactly.
Just lamenting. Another year wasted of your miserable life.
There was
life.
That one year when we all like got drunk and we all got spaded. Remember that?
Yeah, I do.
I actually got so drunk I don't remember that, and now that explains why 20 years later I don't have a dong anymore. I always wondered
why you just have a loose skin that Gallagher smashed.
I don't know if anyone before they listened to this podcast truly understood that when you have that procedure done, they remove all of your genitalia.
So, yep.
You can optionally keep the balls, I think. They're just like a loose set of balls hanging from the rest of your body. They just don't go anywhere.
And Dr. Manflores is the best in the country, so.
Professor Emeritus Titty Manflores. do you guys ever do New Year's resolutions? And then have you stuck with them?
Yeah, we had a New Year's resolution this year to this is going to sound like the dumbest fucking resolution. Our New Year's resolution was to cut out appetizers when we go out to eat at restaurants.
Uh-huh. Did it work?
Yeah. It was because we were like, we would always get like, oh, we got to try this appetizer. And then we'd be so full. And then we would still want to eat the entree. And we'd just feel like, you know, like we'd overeat so much. So we're like, all right, no more appetizers starting 2018. And so we stopped ordering appetizers, except I think we broke it like maybe two or three times on just like special occasions, you know, out for a birthday or something.
Good. Well, I think we should appetize ourselves here with some snacks. And we're going to be eating some snacks from the airline that Chad flew on his trip to Australia. So this is our first bit of airline snacks, and I think it's its own sort of category, its own genre, to see what kind of things you get on airlines. But Chad, do you want to give us the lowdown on how you got these?
Sure. So I mentioned this briefly on another episode, but I just stole them off our Qantas Airlines flight on the way home from our Australia trip. They just had like tons of snacks in the back, and they were just like, oh, come grab them, you know, whenever you want. And everybody was asleep, so nobody was eating them. So I decided to take enough for the podcast. So we've got these. And guys, I don't know if you realize this. Maybe you do. But, you know, this is probably our final Australian-themed episode for a little while.
Uh-huh,
so
right. Here we go.
This is the last chance I'm going to get to say this. But it's a return to Oz. And I'm not talking about the Tin Man.
Question about this plane story. So they told everyone to come get snacks, right?
Yeah.
They announced this, but everyone was sleeping. It was just the middle of the night.
1 a.m. snack time.
No, they announced it as like the flight was taking off or whatever. Like, hey, we're going to put out a bunch of snacks.
As the flight was taking off. Oh, hey, get some. Oh, God, I can't stand up. Everyone's like heaped in the back of the plane.
No, they were running down the whole itinerary for the flight. They were like, okay, the first is going to be a meal service. Then we're going to dim the lights. We'll put out some snacks. And then there'll be breakfast, you know. And so that was that whole thing. And then most people fell asleep after the dinner meal, but I stayed up the whole time and went and raided the snack thing.
I'm picturing like a flight attendant whispering in your ear, there's snacks at the back, Tubby. Go get them.
They even had they had apples there too. Like you could eat just straight up apples sitting there, which seems like a good idea, but that can actually be problematic because I saw one time that somebody took on some flight I was on, somebody took some apples off of the plane, and then at San Francisco Airport they have dogs that will sniff your bags for drugs and stuff, but also for fruits and vegetables, which you're not supposed to bring in. And this person got caught by this dog, and they searched their bag and they found all these fruits. And the person was like, oh, I just took them from the plane. And like, it didn't matter. Like the person still got like, was getting in like all questioned and in trouble and stuff from the airport security people. It's
dogs ripping him apart.
I heard that's what Pablo Escobar was doing. He was just smuggling a ton of bananas into the United States. Right. He's wrongfully accused.
I got these from the plane.
I got all of this cocaine from the plane as well.
Yeah, they just put out a bunch of cocaine in the middle of the night. What am I not supposed to take it for my podcast?
That's why Chad was the only one who wasn't sleeping. He was wired on cocaine.
We do a You Snorted That podcast.
Is there different kinds of cocaine? Three different. Ah, I don't know. This one's got a white powdery consistency.
So for our snacks, we do a 5-point rating system: a love dat, like dat, indifferent to dat, dislike dat, and hate dat. And I think we should start with the coconut, so we can get it out of the way because coconut has a bad track record. And You Tried Dat. And this snack is, the maker is Kez's Kitchen, and it's the Baked Bicky Bites Chalk Coconut Lamington.
So, what the fuck is a Bicky Bite?
There was the maker getting paid by the word? What the hell?
So this seems big, seems kind of biggish for a plain snack to me.
Yeah, and it is Australian made. Like it says on the back, it says Aus Family, made and owned. They smell fairly chocolatey.
They don't taste it, though.
They're crunchy, hard consistency. They're shaped of, I would say, they're about the size of, like, what do you think, like 4 or 5 quarters stacked on top of each other, like that?
They're very dry.
And kind of has the consistency of, like, one of the, that, like, tin of Christmas cookies that you get. There's, like, a cookie or two in there that this really reminds me of.
Yeah. They're very dry, and I would say I can really taste the coconut, which I don't mind. I like coconut, okay, but I get more coconut almost than I do chocolate, I think.
Yeah, I didn't taste the coconut at first, but after chewing it for a little bit, then it starts to really come through. The flavor of the coconut is not so bad. For me, the main problem with coconut a lot of times is the consistency, the sort of like weird chewiness of those like individual strands.
Yeah, we ate a, what was the other coconut snack that was kind of a little ball-shaped thing? I forget what it was, but this is like a snack-snack-a-roon, I think it was called.
Yeah, the chocolate snackaroon.
And this I like much more than that.
Yeah, this is significantly better than that. You and I both gave that snackaroon hate dad, Novak.
Yeah. Geiger, what do you think? You can lead us off.
No, these are good. I don't mind coconut, and it's not as overpowering as some of the other coconut, like, you know, the other stuff we've had. The chocolate chips are good. I don't take the cookie to me doesn't taste a ton like chocolate, but the chocolate chips, if you get one of those in there, it definitely helps. They're a little dry. I don't like the super, like, I'm literally brushing off my desk right now because there's tons of crumbs everywhere. I don't love the consistency, but it tasted fine. It was better than most of the stuff you eat on a plane. Like, at least in America, almost all the snacks are just like basically pretzels. So I'd give it a like that. It's fine. Decent snack.
All right. I like that to lead it off. Chad, what do you think?
They're definitely too dry. They're okay. They're not very good, though. The coconut flavor there and the aftertaste is kind of turning me off to these things. I agree the chocolate chips are a nice little touch, but overall it's too dry. I had one. I don't want any more. So this is getting a dislike that for me.
All right. I think I'm somewhere in between you guys. They're better than I thought they'd be. The coconut taste doesn't bother me. And even as a person who doesn't like coconut, I don't mind the coconut flavor. The cookie itself is just okay. And it's, I think when we're talking about a plain snack, I'm not sure a crumbly cookie is at all what you want. Or what even the airline you would think would want.
Right. And like, I've got pieces stuck in my teeth now, which I don't think you'd really want on an airplane either. Right.
So, but I don't think they're terrible. I could eat them or I could not. I'm going to give it an indifferent. So we have a like, an indifferent, and a dislike. So an okay average start here. Let's move on next to the soy rice crackers. So this is a Santos premium quality soy rice cracker. And the little fine print there says, delicious premium rice crackers, specially sourced for your enjoyment since 1956.
I wonder where these were sourced from.
I don't know, but if it's for my enjoyment, I feel honored. Like, specifically for my enjoyment? That was very nice of them.
Mine says Nick Geiger on it, even though I wasn't even on the flight. It was really weird.
It looks like they have a couple different shapes in here.
Yep.
I
love rice crackers.
There's a long, thin one. There's a kind of short and stubby, chode-like one.
The majority of mine are like a square that's been slightly twisted.
They have different flavors, though. In addition to the chode one, there's other ones.
I have one that's shaped like an L. Like, these are all just like Tetris pieces.
Yeah. Have you guys had a lot of rice crackers before, in general?
I probably eat more on this podcast than I do at any other point.
My grandma used to have them a lot when we were growing up, and we have them in the house now because a lot of them are often gluten-free. So I've come to really like them. They're really salty, usually, which is what I like in a snack. So
these are very crunchy.
Right.
This is more in line what I would think of from an airline snack.
Yeah.
Where it's just like sort of a little bag of like small crunchy things. It's not really getting stuck on my hands or anything like that.
And it's just, it doesn't have a flavor that would be like very divisive. It's just kind of there so that anyone could kind of go at it.
Right. Like a bunch of like, they're not going to hand you a bunch of like garlic Gardettos and like make you choke down everyone else's breath right. The rest of the fight.
So Chad, what do you think? You can lead us off and tell us why you like it or don't.
I mean, these are a big step up from the Lamingtons, coconut Lamingtons, but I don't know. I think they could use maybe sort of like a little more seasoning. They just aren't really, they're not really anything that sort of stands out to me in any way. So I'm going to go middle of the road for these ones, indifferent to that.
Yeah, that's what I feel like I should go, but there's just a little flavor to them that I'm not liking that much. I don't know. There's just not much there. I'm going to just barely, I would rather eat the Lamington over this. I'm going to slide this down to a dislike that. I'm not sure if that's totally fair enough, but I just, there's something that's making me want to stop eating them.
Something about the flavor or?
Yeah, like half of them have no flavor at all. And then the ones that do have a little something to them. I'm not sure what it is, but whatever, like little bits of coating that fall onto some of the pieces and not the others. And it's just not like a very good flavor.
That's fair. Yeah, like I said, I was expecting to like them a lot. I like rice crackers. These, to me, I go the other way. They didn't have enough flavor. To me, they were just kind of bland. I thought the different pieces would have slightly different texture or flavor or something like that. And to me, they just all tasted the same. and they weren't salty enough. I think what I like, especially if you're going to put soy in there, I would expect like a stronger flavor to kind of hang your hat on, and there wasn't. So they were fine. They were innocuous enough. Again, I didn't dislike them or anything. Especially if I was trapped on an airplane, that's all I had to eat, I'd be fine with it. If there was like a party on the airplane and someone tried to give them to me, though, I wouldn't be very happy. So I would just give it an indifferent to that as well.
Two indifference and a dislike, which still puts the Lamington slightly out ahead for now. But there will be a final competitor coming soon.
So I guess you could say I found those snacks to be a little plain. No?
Oh, you are fired.
I saw you start to smile when I was in the middle of my sentence.
I was so happy about it. If we were all sitting in the same room, Chad would stand up, point to the door, and say, "Get out," as he used to back in the day.
I thought the joke you were going to make was, I guess you could say these snacks are a little Qantas.
Yep. That's what I was going to do.
No sense.
I felt that the snacks were really fly. That would have been an awesome joke like in 1992.
It would have.
Yeah, the fly girls from In Living Color, and
right, they were all in the public mind. You know, everyone would just assume you were talking about that show.
These snacks make me want to jet to the store to get them to buy more.
If I ate too much of these and got a heart attack, they would be terminal. And got a heart attack. If I got myself a heart attack from these
snacks make me want to start a group called the Tasty Snack Association, or TSA.
Yeah, I like what you did.
That's
there.
That's right.
We're just
there.
Riffing, guys.
These snacks make me feel really good down in my titty man Flores.
Titty Manfors is also the father of aviation, right? I think he was a distant relative of the Wright brothers. Don't get me wrong.
He was the.
I'm definitely putting my Titty Manfors picture on Instagram.
So time for our segment.
Well, enough winging it.
Time for our segment, and Chad, you've got a news story you're gonna fill us in on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we're returning to news story for our segment here. So this one is not food related, but it is. You know, by the time this comes out, Christmas will have just passed. So this is sort of Christmas related. And in addition, the day that we're recording this is actually this is very relevant because this happened today. So this is about a story that was going to happen today. So this is from SF Chronicle. The headline of the story, SantaCon in San Francisco. Ready or not, those ho-ho-hos are coming. A warning to all Santas, don't get plastered. And yet, Santa will get plastered. Thousands of Santas. But that's what happens at SantaCon, the annual ad hoc gathering in downtown San Francisco of wobbly men and women in Santa and Mrs. Claus suits. It's unofficial. It's an institution. It's either charming or obnoxious, but ready or not, it's on for Saturday. In San Francisco, SantaCon is acknowledged, if not sanctioned. Organizers did not get a permit because Union Square has already issued permits for a skating rink. One SantaCon organizer, who identified himself as, quote, Santa Tom, said the lack of a permit will not and must not stop SantaCon. Union Square can't keep us out, he said in a message to Santas everywhere. Show up anyway. SantaCon is not canceled. Although SantaCon offers little more than red velvet anarchy, there seem to be a few accepted rules. First, bring a toy to give away. Two, wear a full Santa suit, not just a hat. It makes me think they've had Santa show up in just a hat and, like, nothing else.
Give me my beer.
Rule three, don't Santa and drive. See, makes sense. Number four.
Is Santa just code word for drinking?
I guess so. And four, don't assume a paper bag is going to fool a San Francisco cop. The main rule is to stay sober, but Santa doesn't always follow that one. A website FAQ for SantaCon attendees says, can I get smashed? Sure, but if this is what you want to do, stay home. Santa being drunk and disorderly in public isn't fun for anyone. It'll get you into trouble. Making sure Santa doesn't go over the line is much like making sure any other tavern customer doesn't go over the line. Bartender May Coates of the Last Drop Tavern says, it's our busiest day. We'll be packed. We usually don't have much problems with Santas. Another bartender said that SantaCon is always crazy, but in a nice way. She said she's never had to cut off a Santa. Quote, if someone's too intoxicated, it's a bartender's job to tell them they can't drink anymore. But so far, the Santas of her professional acquaintance have behaved themselves. The bar will have extra security guards on duty to make sure Santas remain good, for goodness sake. At the Union Square Sports Bar on Mason Street, the bartender said he expects Santas to be shoulder to shoulder, and he said he would not hesitate to 86 any Santa who was over the limit. He said, when Santa loses his milk and cookies, it's time for him to go. So there you go.
Who wrote that? Mickey Rooney? They'll be put on the naughty list, if you know what I mean.
It was a pretty long article, so there's some parts that I like skipped over, but there was one line at the end where they're talking about how there's going to be extra cops, and it says it also means extra cars for the extra cops to drive off intoxicated Santas to Santa's Village at the Hall of Justice.
I like the best part was don't Santa and drive. It's like, don't stick your Santa in a dirty Santa's Santa.
Come to SantaCon, where famous DJ Santa Man Flores will be Santaing it up.
Our family life was ripped apart. My father had a very serious Santa problem and just wouldn't stop Santaing every night. It was Santa, Santa, Santa.
He had to go to Santaholics Anonymous.
Just a bunch of assholes dressed up in Santa costumes. I love Santa too much. We love you, Santa.
I wouldn't think that people dressed as Santa would be like the unruliest, like getting in fights type of crowd and stuff like that. So it's not that surprising when you read those quotes from people who say that the Santas don't generally give them trouble. I don't picture some like meated up douchebag like dressing up as Santa. You know, the type of guy who would normally be giving people problems.
There was a picture accompanied with this article of one Santa just completely passed out on the sidewalk next to a cop car.
I think I heard about this on the radio. I was in the car this morning and I thought they were talking about SantaCon, and I think it was in like New York or something.
Yeah, I think there's a bunch of these. I read some other article about it too, that it's sort of gone global. And now the SantaCon in New York City, I guess, is even bigger than the one in San Francisco where it started.
So it's just like people dress up as Santa and go to bars. It's not like some sort of actual convention where they talk about Santa techniques or how to properly maintain your naughty list or something.
It's not like the Comic-Con of you know, there's no like cast of Game of Thrones there or whatever. I guess cast of the Grinch movie is not at SantaCon. Anything like that.
Well, I think we should make it a point at some point to all go to SantaCon. That seems like something that we would do and find hilarious. So I think it sounds fun.
I totally would have seen myself going to this, especially like, you know, like in my younger days before I became an old piece of shit that just sits around at home and stares at the wall all day.
Isn't that what Santa is, except on Christmas?
I guess so.
Old fat piece of shit staying up at the North Pole except for one day a year.
You old piece of shit.
I guess I am like Santa.
Santa's essentially a recluse who just gives away all of his largesse one day a year.
Sits around drinking Santa and playing with his Santa all night just like some loser.
Talking to Mrs. Santa saying, can we play hide the Santa? And then winks at her. Santa being his dick right now, that's what I meant.
Got it.
Well, we would all for sure give Santa a love dat, but we may not give this last snack a love dat. Let's see what we think of it. It's Carman's Muesli Bite, and it's apricot flavored. So I'm not sure what to expect from this thing, but it looks like, from the picture, just like a standard granola bar.
Yeah, seems like a small granola bar, small health bar kind of thing.
About the size of those This Bar Saves Lives that we tried.
Right.
Yeah, a little thicker maybe, but it says less than 100 calories, so it's a healthy snack.
Hmm.
Very chewy.
Much softer than a regular granola bar.
Yeah. I taste the apricot. Or was it apricot? I don't remember if we ever settled that.
It's got like a just a real, like, just kind of oaty taste.
Yeah.
There's not too strong of a flavor. But again, like we said before, a lot of these airline snacks are probably geared towards the middle of the road so that anyone could enjoy them. Apricot's like a odd flavor in that I don't eat it in anything, so it's hard to pick out.
Yeah, and I couldn't tell you what an... I mean, I know I've had actual apricot, but I couldn't really pick... It just, in my mind, it just blurs together with peaches. They're like kind of the same, even though I know they taste different.
The best way to eat an apricot is dried. Like a, you can get like, you know, dried apricots.
That's usually how I've had it. I've had
That's
it.
How I like apricot the best.
I need to, are you just covering the bases there? When I eat an apricot, it's usually in jam. I remember having an apricot jam at like some breakfast place nearby our house. And that's all I could really tell you about it. But I'm sure that doesn't taste like real apricot. It's all sugary and stuff. But
I feel like most fruits only exist to be in jams. You know what I mean? Like, most fruits are best for jams. Like, we had a plum tree in our backyard until very recently it died. But we get a bunch of plums every year, and I'm like, I don't want this shit. And then finally we started making jam out of them, and I'm like, oh, plum jam is actually pretty good.
You walked out, saw a tree bearing fruit, and said, I don't want this shit.
Yeah. Plums suck. Who eats a fucking plum? Nobody. They're stupid, but they're great in jam.
You have a plum tree.
Not anymore. It's dead. Got a tumor.
I like plums. I think I'm probably allergic to them now, but I liked them at the time. I remember plums being so juicy all the time that you like bite into one and it just runs down your arm.
Whoa.
What?
Wait, why does it run down your arm?
It's so juicy. Like you're holding it and you bite into it, the juice just drips out of it.
It's just running down. You're just
like that
letting
plum
the juice
gets all Santa on
coat
you.
Your arm. Just.
Why don't you put the juice into your fucking mouth?
All right. You lick it off and stuff, but you're like, you know, I'm just saying they're messy to
eat.
When
you were eating this muesli bar, was the granola just rolling down your arm because you apparently don't know how to eat?
I just take a bite and let it suspend itself in midair. Novak, what would you say is better for jams, fruit or Shaquille O'Neal?
For sure, Shaq.
Shaq was pretty good at jams.
Good. He like broke rim. He like.
You got to be careful though, because if he goes up to dunk, he might roll down your arm.
He broke like a couple entire backboards. That guy's about as good at jams
yeah,
as you can.
That's pretty impressive.
As you can find.
Yeah, but I had so many plums on our plum tree one year that like the weight of it, an entire branch ripped down. And there was this huge branch and just hundreds of plums like all over our yard. So that's the fruit equivalent of breaking a backboard.
No one's going to walk into a NBA arena and see Shaq there and go, I don't want this shit.
Well, if you were the guy having a garden, you might be like, this piece of shit is going to kick my ass all night.
Didn't we used to have discussions back in the day of like how many of us would it take to beat Shaq in like a game of basketball? Like if it was right. Five of us versus yes. Shaq, like could we beat him? And we decided no.
It definitely was, you know, if it was a full court game, I think it was a different story because mm-hmm. he would have to dribble between five people, which I think would be difficult as good as he is.
But in a half court game when he would take two strides and stuff us all through the hoop along with the ball.
Because we could never block any of his shots or stop him or anything. So we would have to make every shot. Plus probably some three pointers.
His best chance would be if it was a full court game but we weren't allowed to guard him until half court. Because he could just get up ahead of steam and just plow through on every one of us.
He just barrels over us like a bunch of bowling pins. We go flying.
Where we weren't allowed to guard him until half court and then wouldn't want to guard him past half court.
Right. Take a charge, Geiger.
Yeah. Can somebody help me down here? You guys are all standing. I'm opening the perimeter. I'm getting my ass gagged. Just throwing me everywhere. Us calling him for fouls constantly. That's a foul, Shaq. Shut up. Just throws us into the stands.
He picks you up and he's like, I don't want this piece of shit. And whips it.
Can you imagine just for one second, we have a like him like a, taking a picture of him posting up any one of us, but it would just look hilarious. We would just look like, I remember I used to get Sports Illustrated for Kids. And if you, they had a thing about how big Shaq was. And I'm, these two instances stuck out my mind.
You used to beat off to it.
I can see Novak getting all excited. Like, yeah, no, I used to get this.
This material is going to be perfect to spay myself to. And then he just like makes a bigger target.
When I got the Brett Favre article, episode or issue, those pages were just glued together almost instantly. I just saw the cover and I was like, splatow! My mom was like, can you read the article? I'm like, leave me alone in my room. I'm studying. Like, oh, that's how upset.
Yeah, you got Sports Illustrated for the articles.
Yeah. So what were you saying and about the Shaq article?
When you opened up the magazine, end to end, like they showed the sole of his shoe covers like one end to the other end of an open full size magazine. And I remember saying you could pour like four whole cans of Coke in there. And I was always just so stunned that like,
why the hell would you do that?
And then drink out of it like a goblet.
Four cans of Coke.
But yeah, I just remember thinking like, what sort of immense human is he? Like, he's so colossal.
Sounds like the same master journalist who wrote the Santa article. Yeah. Like pouring Coke into Shaq's shoe.
But one note to Shaq, don't Santa your shoes before you go out there.
If there was a picture of him posting us up, it would just be our face buried into his ass cheeks. Because
right. Just one arm behind us waving helplessly.
All right, well, we're going to rate these snacks. So I've got the as far as the Carman's bite goes, I'll start it off. I like this. The apricot flavor does not bother me too much. And I like the texture, too. I think it's I like the chewiness of it, that it's not too dry like some granola bars can be. I would eat it. I would choose it over all of these snacks today. So I'm going to give this a like that. Geiger?
It was fine. Mine, maybe it was just mine. Mine had almost all oats. Like, I didn't taste any apricot at all. It was mostly just oat and, like, a little bit of that sugary, not even sugary, but that, like, coating they put on it to hold it all together. It was fine. I mean, it's just a bog-standard granola bar, really. It's a little softer than most granola bars. Wasn't a huge fan. It wasn't bad. It was just kind of, it's like the definition of indifferent to me. It's just the most like mediocre kind of down the line plain snack you can have. If I had more of the fruit in there, maybe it would taste better. But for me, it's just an indifferent.
All right. So if it can get an indifferent from Chad, then it will be the winner. But if he goes dislike, we're going to end up with a tie here. So what do you think?
Yeah, we have a winner. But I still kind of didn't really like it. it was the best of the three things that I ate today. But and I liked it a lot actually at the first bite. But then the more I started to chew it, the flavor just didn't stick with me very well. And again, like Geiger, I didn't really have a lot of apricot in it. So this is weird.
The different pronunciations now involve separate accents that you need to use.
Anyway, indifferent to that.
Well, that indifferent is still enough to make the Carman's Muesli Bite the winner for today. And these ratings are not at all surprising. We were all right around center, a little above or below, and that makes sense for airline snacks. So that'll do it for today. And is there ever an airline snack before we go that stood out that you thought, whoa, this is a great airline snack, or something maybe you wish that they served you, which they don't normally?
I mean, on this very flight, they had a bunch of Tim Tams also, so that stood out. That was great. And I remember there used to be this airline, they don't exist anymore, called Midwest Airlines. And I think they got bought by AirTran or somebody. Yeah. But they used to have fresh baked chocolate chip cookies on the flight, because there was a period of my life where I was flying from Chicago to Atlanta a lot. And I used to try to take Midwest if I could. And it was like, I don't think the cookies were actually baked on the flight, but they were definitely heated up on the flight. And then they would come around and give you these like warm, fresh chocolate chip cookies. And that was awesome. Especially because sometimes I would take like an early Monday morning flight back from Atlanta and there wouldn't be that many people on the plane. And so they'd just give me a whole bunch of cookies because they had way too many for the thing. And I'd just be like, load up the cookies.
Yeah, that's what I was going to. That's the one that stood out to me, the Midwest chocolate chip cookies. Yeah,
that sounds delicious.
Oh, it's great.
I think chocolate chip cookie is about as good a snack as you can get. So a fresh baked warm cookie sounds amazing.
You can get hold of us at youtriedat@gmail.com. You can find us on Twitter, #YouTriedDat, on Facebook, in the You Tried Dat group we have there. You can find us on YouTube, SoundCloud, Instagram, and you can also visit Titty Man Flores' website. I don't know it, but I'm assuming if you just Google Titty Man, I'm assuming that's the first option that'll come up. So just start randomly clicking on those links. And then you should.
You don't even
need
to do that. Just search for titties, and it's the very first result.
Yes, type in titties, and I'm sure it'll bring you to a DJ's website. That's what'll happen. Do not click on image search. Well, or do. I don't know. I mean, maybe you want to. I don't know. But if well, or if some gentlemen are listening to this and they do that, you can tell your significant other you were just researching DJs. Plausible excuse.
We will catch you next time when we will be trying three brand new snacks.
Deuces.
Yep.